Thank you, Professor Paul Davies, for coming to the School of Physics here at UNSW Australia to have a chat with you.
I'm delighted to be here.
Yeah, that's good. So first question, so what is the answer to life, the universe and everything?
Not 42, you
mean. Well, that is the answer. What is the question, I guess?
Well, you've picked the right topic, three topics, yes. Life, the universe and everything. Really, there are, in my view, three fundamental origin questions. One of these is the origin of the universe, the other is the origin of life, and the other is the origin of everything else, of which the most outstanding feature is consciousness.
Oh, right, yes.
And as it happens, I'll be talking about all three of these subjects tonight.
For your tonight's talk, yes.
I might say that the origin of the universe is the one we understand the best. And this can seem paradoxical. People might think, well, isn't the universe, being everything, the hardest thing of all to explain? But from the point of view of physics, we have a pretty good framework for understanding how the universe can pop into being. Then when it comes to the origin of life, we're very much in the dark as to exactly what happened. We know more or less when it happened, but what happened, really don't know. It's a tough one, but I think we're in with the chance of being able to explain it sometime in the next, say, 20 years. Yeah. In other words, it's not a hopeless cause. When it comes to the everything, let's focus on consciousness, then I think it's very difficult because the problem about conscious experience, I don't have to tell you, is that this is something internal to ourselves. We infer that other people are conscious. I sort of assume, or at least it seems like a good working hypothesis to assume that you are conscious because you are responding in the appropriate manner.
I'm nodding my head and smiling and going, yes.
But of course, I can never know whether you're some cleverly programmed automaton of which there's nothing going on inside, that you're just doing the appropriate responses. And so I sort of, on an act of faith, assume I'm surrounded by other conscious beings, but I can't be sure of that. So consciousness is the one thing that is not in a public space. Everything else in science, we can say, well, I looked at this and I found that, and you take a look too, and yes, sure enough, you've discovered something. But when it's
when it comes to consciousness, how do you
I see red in a particular way, and it's very distinctive, and it's not like seeing blue or hearing the ring of a bell or something. These are, for me, distinctive, what philosophers call qualia. They're internal to me. There's no way that I can see the world through your eyes without being you. And so this is one place where, on logical grounds, it looks like science cannot take us. So we may understand one day the what are called the neural correlates of consciousness, which is to say we can map brain function and correlate that with reported experience. I see red, this bit of my brain lights up.
Oh, okay. Fine.
And that program of research is actually proceeding very rapidly. It's improving all the time. So the neuroscientists may be able to map the brain. But that's not solving what philosophers call the hard problem of consciousness, the problem of qualia, the problem of this private, subjective, internal sensation of how.
Would artificial intelligence be incorporated with that, or is that a different thing altogether?
I think artificial intelligence and computational neuroscience are part of this whole project, because at some stage we might think, well, we'll build I hesitate to use the word machine because it carries this sort of baggage that people think of something clunking around, or even a computer because they think of a flickering screen. But an artificial system of some sort, and it may be made out of organic molecules, artificial consciousness. Or at least artificial intelligence. We've got that already. We have machines or systems anyway that respond intelligently to a rather limited range of problems, but we already have that. One day, will we get something that responds in a manner indistinguishable from a conscious being? And often this is called the Turing test after Turing.
And there was recently discovered that a machine actually passed the Turing test.
So from time to time, people claim that they've
passed
the Turing test. But somehow you feel that whatever it is that's doing this probably isn't seeing red in the same way that I'm seeing red, or even has any internal life at all, that it is just a cleverly programmed automaton or a zombie, to use the technical term. Nevertheless, if I could scan your body and reconstruct everything there molecule by molecule, surely I would have a duplicate being And surely this duplicate being would be as conscious as you are.
Yeah.
And so we feel that in principle, building consciousness has got to be possible. Yeah. That would be a brute force method. I don't know how you'd even do it. And it may be there's some fundamental limitation in the laws of physics that will prevent you actually doing that.
So building a consciousness and testing, and then that will create a scientific space for that then?
What I'm doing, just giving you a hypothetical example of how we can't, it would be very hard to say it is impossible to build a conscious entity because I could just duplicate you. So unless we can think of some fundamental reason, some law of the universe or some law of physics or something that says that cannot be done even in principle, then it looks like we could build something. But of course, what we would want to know is, can we build something far less complicated than you, but also we could be confident was conscious after a fashion. And that's the whole field of artificial intelligence. Well, we're talking about artificial consciousness. You can have a conscious being who's not very intelligent. We can imagine doing that. There's got to be some lower threshold than something of your complexity to cross the consciousness line. We don't know what that threshold is. We don't even know what it takes to produce consciousness. We know that in my brain there's swirling electrochemical patterns and that does the job. Why not swirling patterns of foam or something? What is it about some complex systems that bestows upon them this phenomenon called consciousness, and others, we sort of assume, don't have it? What does it take? Nobody's ever described that. Nobody's ever told me what it is about a particular pattern of information flow or whatever, however we want to characterize what's going on up here. What is it exactly about that? Can you write down a mathematical criterion? So some people have tried. Some people have looked at information, the way it's organized, the way it's flowing, and I get to talk to those people from time to time. It's still very much in its formative stage. But there's no agreement on what it takes.
I guess there's no agreement because there's no way of actually testing it, and there's no sort of agreed evidence, I guess.
Well, we go a long way towards this if you could say, aha, I've identified the criterion about what it is about the electricity in my brain that's different from the electricity in this building, and it's that crucial difference that is contributing to consciousness, and I've gone to a lab and I've built a scaled down version of an entity like you, but with the critical patterns, electrical patterns swirling around, and sure enough, look, it's behaving as if it's conscious. So we could imagine doing that, but we're a long way from that yet.
All right, coming back to something more tangible, you said before that we have more of an understanding of the beginnings of the universe.
Yes, we do.
But more of a speculative question is, what do you think happened before the Big Bang?
It's the first question I will deal with tonight.
Oh, right, okay.
Always comes up in conversation.
Yep.
And there are two obvious answers, something and nothing.
yes.
Now, to say nothing happened before the Big Bang, what does that mean? Well, it means not just no matter or energy, but no space or time as well. And so that's a very old idea. It goes back to at least Augustine in the 5th century, that the world was made with time and not in time. And it's echoed in Einstein's general theory of relativity that puts a singularity, a space-time singularity, at the beginning of the universe, at the beginning of the Big Bang. And that singularity means space and time don't continue back before that. Okay. And so here we have an origin of everything that is physically relevant, and there is nothing in the laws of physics to preclude that. Indeed, the laws of physics describe exactly what I've just said. Mm. However, you still have to assume that the laws of physics exist in some transcendent sense, that they are, if you say that the laws of physics are brought into existence with the universe, like the maker's mark stamped on the universe the moment it sprang into physical existence, then you are left with a mystery, because if the laws and the universe came into being together, you can't appeal to the laws to explain the universe. Mm. But if you want to say, no, the laws somehow already exist outside of space and time, like a Platonist believes that mathematics exists outside of space and time, it has an independent, transcendent existence. If you appeal to transcendent laws of physics in that manner, then you can explain how the universe comes into being. But of course, people will want to know, well, where do these laws of physics come from? And why those laws rather than some other? It's the second question I'll be talking about tonight. Now, I've dealt with the universe from nothing. What about the universe from something? Suppose there was something there before. Well, a popular idea at the moment, it's been around for about 20 years, is that the Big Bang, what we call the Big Bang, is the origin of our universe, but not the entire physical thing. It's that it's one of many bangs scattered throughout space and time, and the assemblage of all of these things is truly eternal, has no beginning and no end. And so within that overall framework, universes like ours can pop into existence by some quantum tunneling process or something, and away they go, and they have their life cycle of birth, evolution, and maybe death, and we're just one instance of that. Now, you might think, well, that solved the problem of what happened before the Big Bang. Of course, it hasn't solved the problem of physical existence, because there still have to be laws of physics in this wider multiverse, this overall superstructure. And one could ask, well, where did those laws come from? And was there a beginning, an ultimate beginning, to this whole assemblage of things? And if there was, then we're right back to the same problem as we had before. So we're sort of moving the bump in the carpet here, and yet, so long as we have fixed immutable laws, it seems to me that there's no other way of getting around the problem. The name of the game changes quite dramatically, however, if you don't regard the laws as absolute, universal, infinitely precise, transcendent mathematical relationships, but you regard them as something that can evolve and change and be part of this package. And then you're in with the chance of trying to explain the universe, or a multiverse if you prefer, in terms of co-evolving laws and states in a way that there's a feedback from the one to the other. And in particular, you have to have a feedback through time, otherwise you can't explain in a self-consistent way. So my dream is that one day we'll be able to explain the universe in terms of laws that themselves are explained by the universe in a sort of loop, and that this loop will stretch into the past and stretch into the future, and that the reason the universe is as it is will have to do with this two-way arrow of time connecting principle. No, it's not causation. Nothing we do now can change the past or alter the past or even signal the past. But what we do now, we know connects with the past. We know this from the foundations of quantum mechanics.
We know
Einstein called it spooky action at a distance, because it referred to what's going on here and here simultaneously being connected. But a change of reference frame means that this is in the past of that, and it's still connected. So we know that quantum physics connects the present with the past, but it can't be used to change the past or signal the past.
You mentioned fundamental laws, and one of the reasons why you're here visiting Australia, and particularly this university, is Professor John Webb, where he's working varying constants. Are you helping him come up with dream other ideas of exploring that space, or can you talk about that collaboration there?
I follow very carefully John's work and those of others over the years about varying fundamental constants, and I've always been interested in this idea, partly because it connects with what I've just said, that is, are the laws of physics fixed and immutable, or are they evolving or co-evolving with the universe in some manner? But it's just really important in any case to check that these laws have remained constant over time. I wrote a paper on the constants varying with time in 1972, I think.
Oh, right.
It was.
Okay.
Yeah, so I've been in this game myself really rather a long time. And of course, one can always ask, how can we improve the tests for the constancy of these things? And what John is doing is very much at the cutting edge, so much at the cutting edge, it's hard to find anyone else in the world who can sit down and duplicate those results. So. When you become so specialised that that you're the only one, then it gets very difficult to drum up support. Well, what it really needs is two or three other groups to drop everything and do their own analyses and say, sure, this is exactly what we find.
Is that what you're coming in to help out with that? Or?
Well, I think because a lot of this involves crunching numbers and data analysis, I'm completely incompetent at that. But what I feel I have a handle on is some of the conceptual foundations. So, for example, one of the things that interested me is if the fine structure constant alpha should change with time. They're depending a bit on how you define your units and things, that you can see this as like the electric charge changing with time. And then I worried some years ago about if you had a maximally charged black hole and the electric charge were to change, would you violate cosmic censorship? That is, would the black hole disappear and would you have a naked singularity, or would it violate the generalized second law of thermodynamics and reduce the horizon area? And there are all sorts of spin-off questions of that sort that would be opened up if it turned out, even microscopically, a tiny amount, if the fine structure constant should vary. So that's my main interest in it. Of course, not just the fine structure constant, but all of the fundamental constants of physics. Because we want to know, is there a final theory that would produce these constants as part of the theory's output? Are these numbers, like the fine structure constant, just arbitrary, or are they connected to a body of mathematics that nobody's yet put together? It's always been my dream of deriving the fine structure constant, which famously has this value close to 1 over 137.
Deriving
it from some fundamental theory. And I tried to do that many times over my career. I've returned to that thinking, well, you know, sometimes I think, is there a nifty mathematical formula that would crank that out? So even though you didn't have a theory, you'd have a formula. Well, nobody's found one yet.
Would that be sort of spurring the motivation why you're so multidisciplinary? Because you're known as a cosmologist, astrobiologist, a physicist, and indeed a writer with all your books. Is that the main motivation? You've been labeled with these ideas, but you're really answering big questions.
Right. I think I director of something called the Beyond Center for Fundamental Concepts in Science at Arizona State University, and our motto is confronting the big questions.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah.
And so the sort of big questions we confront are things that we've already touched on, the origin of the universe and the origin of life are two of the big ones, but also the nature of the laws of physics. Plus, on top of everything else, I run a big cancer research program.
Yes.
So what is cancer? A lot of people think, well, is that a big question? It's a big problem, but is it scientifically a big question? Well, it is. This is the most studied phenomenon in biology. There's over a million published research papers, and yet it's not understood. So here we have a fundamental biological phenomenon, which people think of as a disease, but it's not. It's a phenomenon. It's a condition. It's a way of doing eukaryotic life, basically, alternatively from the standard way of doing it, and nobody knows what it is, and its evolutionary origins are sort of lost in the mists of time, but we're trying to uncover them. And so it's connected intimately with the emergence of multicellularity. And that's a deep problem, because when you think about the world prior to multicellular forms, there was just one imperative: replicate, replicate, replicate. And bacteria still do it. That's just what they do. They're in effect immortal. But the transition from the single-cell world to the multicellular world meant a very different logic for doing life, because then what happened was that most of the cells outsourced their immortality to specialized germ cells, like sperm and eggs. The rest of the cells accept programmed cell death, called apoptosis, as a price to pay for getting someone else to do all their immortality stuff. And cancer is a breakdown of that contract between the individual cells and the body. Cancer is a disease of bodies, and so it really is relevant only in connection with bodies. But you know, how did bodies arise? Bodies are unions of cells with a very special set of rules, which had to somehow evolve out of this single cell world. And it's evolved many times, turns out at least 20 times. Independently, multicellularity has evolved. And it seems to me that cancer goes hand in hand with whatever it is that drove that transition to the multicellular world. So it does represent, actually, biologically, a very big question.
Yeah, so it ties in with the origin of life question as well.
It does.
So and indeed, I guess another natural sort of astronomy question from that, are we alone in the universe? And
that's right. The origin of life, I mentioned, is still a tough one, and we don't really know how it happened. We may never know exactly how on Earth it happened. Of course, we don't know that life on Earth began on Earth. It could have come from somewhere else. But wherever it came from, Earth life, if we call it that, had a beginning, and we don't know how that transition occurred. And because it's lost in the mists of time, it goes way, way back, billions of years. There's almost certainly no trace of the processes, the mechanism that turned non-life into life. The best we can hope for is to understand it well enough to be able to say, well, it's really quite likely or it's very unlikely. At the moment, it's completely wide open. It could be that the transition to life is so improbable, requires so many special circumstances, that it happened only once in the observable universe. I'm prepared to believe that. It's equally possible that given a planet like Earth, you wait a few tens of millions of years and it's inevitable that life crops up. Now, in my career, spanning several decades, the pendulum has swung. It used to be supposed that life was a bizarre freak unique to Earth. Today, it's fashionable to say that the universe is teeming with life, that billions of Earth-like planets and they all have life on them. There's not a shred of evidence for that. In fact, the basic science hasn't really moved on since people were assuming that Earth was the only planet with life. And so here we have something which is totally wide open, but whether or not we're alone in the universe hinges on precisely that. If life is easy to make and happens often, then we might expect there to be cosmic company. But if it turns out that only one in a trillion planets will have life on them, then probably we're alone in the universe. And so that's where we're at. One big question.
I like sort of Carl Sagan's quote, is that if it is just us, it just seems like an awful waste of space.
Right. And of course, so if I put my philosopher's hat on, yes, as opposed to my physicist's hat, I would say, what's the universe for? There's all this stuff out there. It is a waste of space. And so, but then, of course, my skeptical scientific colleagues will say, you're putting a value judgment on it that goes beyond the scope of science, and you shouldn't do that. And then if you ask me, what would I want? What do I, people often say, do you believe there's life out there? And I say, well, I'm a scientist. That what I believe is irrelevant. Yeah. The evidence accounts. But if you ask me what I would like to be the case, then I would love it to be teeming with life. I'd love to think that we're an intrinsically bio-friendly universe. Mm. And I'd love even more for there to be sentient beings out there for us to communicate with. And I chair a curious body called the SETI Post-Detection Task Group, which means that we think about, well, supposing we pick up a signal from ET, what next? And it's sort of enlarged a bit now to supposing we get incontrovertible evidence that we are not alone, but maybe not a signal or a message. It may just be a piece of evidence, this is inexplicable in natural terms. And so then what? And so it's a motley collection of journalists and scientists, and we had a priest who sadly died recently, and a couple of lawyers and science fiction writers.
All different people, just in case this thing actually does happen.
That's right.
So, wow, just being prepared.
That's right.
Yeah. Yes. Cool. Now, just slightly switching gears, coming back, if you cast your mind back to the first Hubble Deep Space images, the Hubble Deep Field, what was your first reaction when you saw that image?
My first reaction was that these pictures are fakes.
Oh, right.
Because the resolution just seemed too good to be true. Once they fixed up the eyesight problem of Hubble, I have to say I had the same reaction when Voyager first sent back Rings of Saturn images. Oh, right. I thought, this is some artist's impression of what they'd look like close up, but no, they're the real thing. And I suppose to a theoretical physicist like me, all experimental physics and astronomy seems like magic. Mm. I visit observatories, I go to labs, I talk to people, they're manipulating atoms, getting images from the edge of the universe, they're doing this stuff that it might just as well be magic. You put me in a lab, I wouldn't know where to begin. And so I have huge admiration for people that can go. It's not just one thing. It's not, I used to, when I was a teenager, I had a camera. Okay, and I understood how the camera works pretty thoroughly. And I went out and I took pictures and developed them. And I understood what was happening at every chain of the process. But if you say to me an image like the Hubble Space Telescope, I can tell you about the optics of the telescope.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's layer upon layer of clever stuff going on between the telescope gathering the photons and you looking at the picture in the newspaper or magazine. And it's that layer upon layer that is a mystery to me.
Cool. You mentioned you, as a teenager, you liked the camera. Was there a, like an early occurrence that provided a spark to pursue a scientific career? Or?
Yeah, I tell people I was born a physicist.
Oh, right. Okay.
And from my earliest memories, that's what I wanted to do. I had particular interest in the sky and astronomy. I think what intrigued me most was the idea that there could be things going on that you couldn't actually see. You know, hidden influences, x-rays or atoms doing stuff. And it all seemed to me totally wonderful. So it was really like a make-believe world that was all around us, but which you couldn't access in daily life. So it was a sort of escapism. Mm. And I often say that that's because I grew up in post-war London. It was really, really boring. Because those post-war years, you know, Britain had been economically devastated by the Second World War. There was lots of bomb damage. The country was just recovering, huge debts. And so everybody was very poor by present standards. We didn't feel poor. We thought it was all wonderful. But, you know, things like televisions. We didn't have televisions or cars or didn't go away on holiday. It was very rare. Didn't have fancy toys like kids do these days. So everything we did was a world of simplicity and make-believe. Built a camp or connected up pegs to pretended they were trains. And,
oh, right.
You know, just really basic stuff like that. And then just seemed to me, doing a little bit of reading when I was 7 or 8, that there was this magic, this wonderland. I just need to look up or think about atoms or something. And that there was simple stuff you could do with bits of string, a torch battery and a few things like that, that opened up this wonderful world of hidden forces and this reality that's all around us. So for me, from a very earliest age, but very specifically when I was 12, my parents bought me a photographic development kit. And that's, you know, look, it seemed like magic to me at the time, seeing the image looming up out of the development fluid. And then I made a telescope when I was 14, and the only part that I paid for was the mirror.
A reflecting telescope.
Yes. The rest was had a linoleum tube and found a little eyepiece lens from a microscope that somebody had thrown out, and you know, put the whole thing together, and that was great. And then I ended up building a bigger telescope and grinding my own mirror for that. So did all this in my teens. And then another story I like to tell, because for those of my generation, was that a further leap occurred when I was given a copy of Norton Star Atlas by the then MP Margaret Thatcher, who subsequently, of course, became the Iron Lady, Britain's most famous Prime Minister probably ever. She was just our local MP at the time. And I still have this atlas with her signature in it. And so,
it's probably worth a lot of money.
I don't know, but it's a valued possession. So all this set me on a career into science by my mid-teens. I've never really thought of doing anything else.
Oh, wow, that's pretty cool. It's a huge difference to probably today's generation when everything's provided to them. And like when you said you've got to think of things, though, use your imagination to put stuff together.
I know. First of all, it's a bit depressing how constrained just ordinary school science experiments are, because of all the safety factors that nobody cared about when I was at school. It's blow things up all the time and wire stuff up and make x-rays, and you know, it was much freer environment. But also I think because all of the entertainment that is such a distraction today, all of the various electronic gadgets and all the texting and the website screaming at you and all of this stuff and the 50 or 100 or 500 television channels, and it's all a distraction, really. And I don't think it's improved the quality of people's experiences throwing all this
stuff.
Do
you think you have an idea of actually solving that, maybe? Or not solving it, but
turn off. It's very simple, yes.
But I guess they don't want to take away their electronic devices and that.
No, I mean, obviously that it's not all bad. It's very good to be connected. But I think the attention span of young people has been seriously eroded. And this I see time and again if I'm interviewed, say, on television to explain something. Yeah. And you explain something in physics, and often there are four steps in the explanation.
Yeah.
And you'll get about two steps into it, and the questioner will just interrupt me with some other sort of irrelevant question, because nobody can sustain for more than 5.5 seconds or whatever is the, you know, people measure, you know, any thread of argument. So what that's doing to the human brain and what it means for the next generation, I don't know. But I think it's seriously depressing.
Well, that's something I would like to try and work out myself, because it's the sort of the position I'm in, just try and see if I can inspire the next generation. But it is a hard one, because... Yeah.
Well, we've done well today, because we've been talking at great length.
Yes.
And it's been possible.
It's been fantastic. I just love hearing the stories.
Develop some arguments that require more than one soundbite, and that's the important thing. If you really want to engage the big questions, you can't just give a one-word answer, or as they say in the United States, the elevator speech. You know, give me the elevator speech on the origin of life. Well, it can't be done.
Wow. Well, there are certainly big ideas and big questions that we discussed here. Well, thank you very much for your time, and all the best for your talk tonight about answering the six big questions and here at the university. So thank you again,
thank
Professor
Paul
Davies.
Thank you. I've enjoyed our conversation.
All right. Thank you very much.